Get out of the car!
Get out of the car!
Get out!
Police, you're under arrest.
You're wanted.
You're under arrest.
Get down. Hold it. Go back.
You're under arrest.
Go back.
We made routine check. When was that?
2004.
It featured Kano and it featured Mike Skinner. And I feel like all of our verses were quite impactful, you know, at that time. We all had our different stories. And we all had key moments in the video. And it was an amazing time, to be honest with you, recording it and obviously then filming it. The message hasn't changed. I say youths and, you know, youths having to deal with all types of racial profiling and
stereotyping.
Yeah, and obviously this is a thing that happens quite a lot.
It was there before us and it's here now and it's going to be there after us. And for me, like, we're obviously grown now more than then. And even though we might not get as, you know, quote unquote, harassed by the police now, this tune is like pretty much a voice of kids that get stopped, you know, like people can relate.
For me, it just resonated with me and so many people. Like, we used to bang it in our cars when we were driving because it was reflective of what happens in our community. Growing up in South East London, growing up on Elmsby Estate, in and around Peckham, this was exactly what happened on a day-to-day basis. And for us now, that song was really kind of pivotal for us because we understood, and as I said, it resonated with us like deeply. And it was really good for us to see this, and especially in the mainstream in that respect, and the song was so successful. In terms of the Mitchell Brothers, it was great that they were kind of highlighting an issue that we face in society. So nothing's changed.
It was mad because at that time, I'm getting stopped by the police all the time, and that's like something that you can relate to, you get me? And the way they delivered it, it's like, it was clever because they're like, it was kind of funny. There was jokes in the lyrics and funny, like smart little lines and stuff like that. So it was relatable and it was dope. And then the link up was mad because it had Kano on it as well, innit? And the streets. So yeah, I just remember watching it thinking, right, this is different. You get me? But it's different, but it's relatable.
For me, it's interesting that 16 years later, it's still quite pertinent. And on reflection, I think it was a bit shocking to hear the police being challenged, because at the time I'm not driving, you know, I'm not thinking about getting stopped in a car, but we're getting stopped and searched on the road and you really ain't got no power, you ain't got no chat. You can be rude as much as you want, you're still gonna be in handcuffs, you're still gonna get stopped and searched, you might still get taken to police. You know, it's all out of your hands. So for me, kind of reflecting on that song, it was almost like it was like a beginning of trying to take your power back. You know, you're actually getting into a dialogue and arguing with the police officers, say you can't do that. And for me, can't believe it's still the same.
My recollection of it was a real pivotal moment. It dealt with like social issues at the time. Unfortunately, there's still the same issue exists now. But yeah, I remember it being a pivotal moment of like taking, being young. So actually looking at it as like, it was a bit funny. Obviously serious, but it was like, they took a serious moment, something that we all experienced and kind of, saw the humour in it, but brought the seriousness of it to light.
It was one of those tunes where it's just a catchy tune. It wasn't of that era. There was a lot of tunes that's gassy and jumpy, but that was just more of a sing-alongy sort of vibe. I think I was young enough to understand it, but obviously I'm a grown man now, so it's like when I listen to it now, I get the more essence of it all. Whereas back then, it's just they're talking about routine checks, but. You know, as soon as you get older, it's like you kind of deep what they was actually talking about, what they were saying, and it's especially when you link it to now times, is that you kind of see that this little thing of routine checks and police stopping people without needing to has been going on for a long time. So
when we got the call to do the new version, updated version, we jumped at it because at the time we got the call, obviously it was the Black Lives Matter had just, you know, come into play. George Floyd situation happened, and was very much, let's do this, man, because, you know, let's rather than go out there and march, rather than throw a load of signs up on our Instagram, let's do something that we do best. We make music. Let's kind of champion that emotion through the music. So, you know, the lads came in, they recorded the hook, then done the verses, we developed the beat, we made it into like a drilly kind of vibe, which is what was current, was popular right now. And yeah, man, we created a solid track, got Sneakbo on the record.
That song is relevant, it's been relevant then, and it's still relevant now. And yeah, I'm happy to be even a part of the new version. Because yeah, it's just something that a lot of us are going through, and it's good to just show the message and hopefully a change. It's been going on for years, so I don't know if a change is going to come, but hopefully an officer can look at this and understand where the youths are coming from.
Sneakbo has been through a load of, you know, issues with the police, and you know, that's actually essentially prevented him from ascending in his career. You know, obviously, fortunately now that, you know, he's free to perform and stuff, but he's had his a load of run-ins with the police, so it made sense that he would be able to speak on this matter, and it fitted really well and it worked.
Control to 229, request traffic stops. Black Range Rover, Lima Kilo 20, Alpha Bravo Delta. I repeat, Lima Kilo 20, Alpha Bravo Delta.
Yeah, confirming Lima Kilo 20, Alpha Beta Echo.
It's always an RC3 situation, you know what I'm saying? And you know, once they have some form of inkling that this kid could have been involved in this, involved in that, whether they've got proof or not, they're going to stop you, search you, manhandle you. I mean, not so long ago, I was looking up on the Instagram and this kid was getting abused by the police, literally. And I think all he did was he was recording the police station. He was recording the police station. Two police officers were in the car. They asked him what he's doing. He said, look, I'm just recording. You know, it's free for me to record. And they literally came out of the car, held him up, put his hands behind his back, kneed him in the back. For what reason?
Right, my thing is, if you're known for like gang activity, for weapons or drugs, and you get stopped, then I think it's fair play. That's your lifestyle. The police are going to be onto you. I get that. If there's been a crime committed and you honestly fit the description, then cool. But my thing is just the way police certain times conduct these routine checks, and the majority of the people being young black males who they're stopping, I think I don't agree with that.
So a person in a car, unless they've ran their plate, what else are they really looking for? So it's not thought about too much when it comes to driving, but I've always thought, okay, what's your justification for stopping multiple black people when driving?
For me, it's just totally negative. I mean, I've been stopped and searched over 30 times since the age of 14. I've been stopped this year in my car at least 4 times. The most notable one was during lockdown, where I was stopped and searched under Section 23 of the Misuse of Drugs Act. And the officer said that I looked like a drug dealer and just racially profiled me, said I looked like a drug dealer. These are the typical cars that drug dealers drive in this area where there's high crime. So for me, it's quite negative. I mean, black boys are 19 times more likely to be stopped than anybody else in the population in terms of police. But it does come down to conscious bias and down to your kind of worldview and how the black British community are, which isn't always true, and we're not all negative.
It's so deep-rooted, isn't it? Something that's been happening for a long time, years. Because I have, like, not in a bad way, but I have, like, friends that are like white that have never been stopped ever. You know what I mean? So it's like it blows their mind for them to say, like, you know what I mean? Like, even to have my seat back or anything like that can cause more attention for me getting stopped. It's like, it's pretty sad.
That's a very interesting question, because the truth is, when you educate yourself in the law, you understand that a traffic stop means that a police officer can stop you without reason and ask you to present your driver's license and proof of insurance, which means you will never potentially know why you actually got stopped, let alone if it was because of your race. So for me, it is really to do with the grounds. You know, if you get stopped in your car and it's for a traffic stop, you know, that's the law allows that.
I think the police therefore abuse like their power with the stops and search while people are driving. And like, from my experiences anyway, if there's like more than three black boys in a car, we're 100% gonna be getting pulled over if the police see us. And yeah, like, there won't be no reason. Like, we wasn't speeding, we probably was using our indicators, and the first excuse would be the car smells like weed or something.
Panic mode when you see them. You know, because you feel, oh, they're gonna stop me. Is this the day they're gonna stop me? Mm. And yeah, that's which shouldn't be how we should feel, but it's over the years of, and obviously social media, seeing a lot of police just stopping the black youth for like no reason, it just automatically triggers that emotion.
Where's the car? Lee's got some information that there was a weapon in the car and they stopped us, and literally I had like red dots on my clothes, and I was thinking, what the hell? So I put my hand on the
oh, it is real,
this is serious.
Wow.
Yeah, I put my hands
up. I forgot about that, to be honest with you.
What, do you remember?
Yeah, but I just forgot.
Oh.
Literally, yeah.
Yeah, so that was a crazy time, and I remember my cousin got pulled out of the car. I literally froze. I was like, I ain't moving for a second. You know, I ain't flinching. So that was one crazy time, and there was no weapon at all. You know, there was no weapon at all. They let us go. But hey, you know, it's one of those things where I feel, you know, that's where a routine check for me speaks volumes, because it's an everyday, for some people, it's an everyday occurrence.
Man was just cruising, you get me? Man went to drop off some groceries to mum. Me and my bro, we're driving, boom. Come up to the high street, waiting at the lights. We're just chatting, just rapping about family or whatever. Two twos, now doors fling open. His door flings open, my door flings open. Yo, get out of the car. Man's like, what's going on? Man's in handcuffs. You get me? Obviously, it's in a local area, so people are driving past, they're seeing us like in handcuffs and that. It's not a good look, you get me? I had a Ford Fiesta, like an old one, an old full plate. Hardly got pulled over, and then as soon as I got my new thing, I remember within days of getting it, armed police pulled me over. Papa come, put guns to my head, I had to put my hands up and stuff. Like, they said apparently, somebody allegedly, there's a firearm in this car or something, so they put guns to my head. Said, yeah, like, it's mad. They asked me, what do I do for a living? And I told them, it's crazy, I actually work with young people, and I try to bridge the gap between people like yourself and young people. But here I am, someone that's trying to do that, and look how I get treated. So it's a bit of a mad one.
I stopped off to get some dates to break my fast during Ramadan and got back in my car, back onto the Wharf Road, and saw some blue lights behind me. Pulled over, not thinking it was for me. And then they said, look, we're stopping you because you did a dodgy maneuver. You look like a drug dealer. You look quite suspicious. And I just said, what do you mean look suspicious? What have I done? It's got to be based on reasonable cause. So they stopped and searched me for about 45 minutes. Was able to break my fast. I was pretty angry, frustrated. It also was the second anniversary of one of my mentees' deaths. He was killed on the 5th of May, 2018, Sir Raheem Barton. So I wasn't in the best of moods. So getting stopped and searched and being kind of profiled as a drug dealer, I just wasn't, you know, I wasn't feeling it. And I got angry. And that's how I always got it. It's because I've been stopped over 30 times, been assaulted by police officers, never got any justice. It's always been a very, you know, massive relationship breakdown in terms of the Black British community and the police. So for me, I was just angry. But then once that anger subsided, I just said, I have to change. I have to literally find a solution to this. And in the video that I did on Instagram Live, I said, look, I'm going to get you guys in the room. I'm going to get the Met Police to pay me to train you guys. And I managed to do that within 6 weeks.
Denzel Bentley, 25 years old, professional boxer, current British middleweight champion. Been boxing 7 years, amateur and pro altogether. And I won the British title in November 2020. You know, the lights went on, they pulled me over. Like, hello, what's going on? Blah, blah, blah. Asked for my details, asked if this is my car. I said yes, they checked everything, it's fine. Then they went on to say they can smoke cannabis. But I'm a boxer and I don't smoke. Even if I was, I wouldn't smoke right before training. So like, there's no cannabis in this car. Like, you guys being serious to say, yeah.
For me, I've been stopped, I think, probably over 100 times, you know, growing up. And again, even myself now in this position that I'm in, you know, as a multiple graduate, I've gone to university 3 times, you know, 2018, I was elected as a local councillor. And lastly, I was still stopped in the constituency that I represent, that I was elected to represent.
I think we're up to about number 30 now times in total. So probably give you a little flavour of a couple, if that's okay. So the first one that I can remember was like 17. Like got my breakfast, got my car, drive around the area, you know, music blaring, like anyone would do if they got their first car, just happy. And yeah, just being stopped and asked about insurance. And I was like, well, of course I've got those things. Like, my mum wouldn't let me drive. Like, my mum wouldn't let me do that if I didn't have those things. Like, sort of, like, I was so confused. But then you start to get to realise that that's just the way it was. And the amount of times then afterwards, it was just like a routine thing. It was routinely, like, if it weren't once a month, then you'd be kind of surprised at a young age that I was being so stopped so much.
I was like, cool, what? So they pulled me out the car, searched the car, but this was a proper, like, deep search. They opened the bonnet, everything. Like, these guys must think I'm El Chapo or something, but obviously they've taken me to the back of the van as well, like, stripped me to, like, my boxers, searched me, trying to tell them, like, yo, I'm just getting training, but they're not trying to hear it. So they've kept me in the van for a bit. They don't know, they're on their walkie-talkies, whatever, calling. I don't know, but they've just carried on searching my car, moved everything in the car. Like, they've even taken some parts that I didn't know can come out. That was a proper thorough search, I was baffled. And then they've come back to me and said, oh, so where you going? I'm going training, like I told you. They've opened my bags, seen the bags, said, okay, cool.
I was taking pictures of my brother, and I saw some police walking, and they were quite far down. I said, you know what, let's just move along. Don't know why, but I guess this is something that was in me. Like, just move along. We haven't done anything wrong. We're just taking pictures. But we started to walk in a different direction. And the minute we started walking, I looked back and they started running after us. And they caught up to us and they slammed me against the wall. And they were like, what are you doing around here? What are you doing around? I'm like, I'm taking pictures. The camera's around my neck. And they proceeded to say that I'd stolen my dad's camera that I was using. And they were telling me, where do I live? Asked me, where do I live? And trying to catch me out. And I was like, I live over there. And I'm like, where, what number? And I told them what number I lived at. And they were like, oh, that's not the number you said. And I was like, it is. And they tried to say, what's the name of the camera? And you know, when you've got like 3 police officers around you, they're like, it's intimidating. And they're all talking at the same time, it's confusing. And I remember in that moment, I was about 18 at the time. They asked me, what's the make of the camera? And I was like, it's a Sanyo camera. And they were like, I tried to look down at the camera and they did this to me so I couldn't move the camera. And it turns out it was a Panasonic camera. And yeah, they were like, yep, yep. And it was like, oh, they're gonna nick me for this. And you know, after their questioning, they realized that I was just taking pictures.
Where was I? I think I was in Brixton and I've just, driving up Brixton Road, I've seen an undercover car go past. When, like I said, I weren't speeding, I weren't indicate. I mean, I was just driving normal, like yeah, how I meant to be driving. And yeah, they spun around, pulled us over, more backup to come. And it's just got like hectic. It's just crazy. Like, this is what they do. Pulled us for no reason, had us there for like 40 minutes or, yeah, 40 minutes to an hour, and no one was arrested.
They looked in my face. I just knew it was gonna happen. The bully van spun round, chased me into a state. Well, not chased me, I was just driving normally. They just came into the state, pulled in front of me. About 20 officers jumped out, where you go in, da da da. But because I was young, my emotion was very much confrontational. What are you stopping me? Because I knew I didn't have nothing wrong. There was nothing wrong. I knew why they was pulling me over, because I'm a black kid wearing a hat in a certain estate. They jumped out. I jumped out. Well, you can't do this, because I'm illiterate with the knowledge that I have to really shut them down, because I was younger. I haven't done no research or anything, but I knew I wasn't wrong. So I was just like, you can't do this, da 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 da. And they came with a jargon. Police have their ways. No, well, you know, you're in an area where it's high crime with people that wear hats like that. And you know, we can smell something. It's like a lot of stuff they were saying they could get away with because I wasn't, as I said, literate in regards to, you can't do this under section this. You can't just do this, do you get what I mean? So they searched the car, found out nothing was wrong, and it's like a, okay, there you go.
Most recently, it was actually last week, in fact, driving home from football, and the police followed me for about 10, 15 minutes and literally waited until we turned onto my road to put the blue lights on and pull me over. Wound down the window and literally just asked me where I was going, asked them if they'd done their checks. They had. See, the car's registered and insured in my name. We was on my road, so it was just amazing that they waited to do that, which annoyed me, but they then started to get aggressive. And that's just how it's been. It's been like that for years, and it's a shame really that in this day and age, society hasn't changed.
I believe it would have been a Friday or Saturday evening. A bunch of friends, you know, all young black men. Myself was driving. We were driving into the West End. During that era, obviously this is when stop and search had been introduced. You, as a young black man, you would be prepared for it. Okay, cool, guys, listen. There's two of you in the back. Nobody don't wear no hoodies. Take your hat off, blah, 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 blah. All of these things that we would have to do just because we were aware of being young, black, and being in an affluent area. As I said, we were going into the West End. We were pulled over. The reason for us being pulled over was, quote unquote, you guys may not have insurance. I had insurance, I had my driver's license with me. And it was a thing which where, because you knew that this would always happen, you always have, you know, like literally, okay, cool, it's about to happen. Make sure you got your driver's license, XYZ. So everything ticked off, which regarding what they needed.
I've had police pull me over just because, for the simple reason they just didn't like the look of me. Do you know what I'm trying to say? Like, and I can tell it's for that they didn't have a look at me, because when they've stopped me, they've got nothing to say. Do you know what I'm trying to say? Like, and they're talking about they can smell weed in the car, and I don't, well, at the time I wasn't smoking weed, and I don't smoke in my car anyway. Do you know what I'm trying to say? Like, so you can't smell no weed in the car. You get me? You're just looking for any excuse. Or like, when they come and talking about there's robberies in the area and all these stupid stuff, and it's like, what the hell has that got to do with me? Do you get what I'm trying to say? Like, you just do your job. Like, you can't just see a black man and just think, yeah, let me stop him, or I'm wearing a fitted hat or whatever, and think that I just, everybody just a criminal, you're just tarring everybody with the same brush, you get what I'm saying? So it's happened bare times, even before, like when you just get stopped multiple times in the day for no reason, and it's frustrating, you get what I'm saying? And then by like the third time or something, your attitude, your energy is different.
What's the reason for searching the car? You know, you guys, you know, in an area which where, you know, oh, the car's not registered around here. And my answer to that was, I didn't know that, you know, you could only drive in areas where your car was registered. So. That was very interesting. And then it then led to nothing, just a it created a very hostile environment between us and them. But nothing escalated. And it was once again, you know, they didn't find nothing. There was no real reason for them to stop us. And it was just like, yo, guys, apologies. You know, feel free to be on your way.
Rhythm babies born into systems of disharmony. To us, blue lights rarely mean safety. when sirens scream. Our silences play loudly the sound of arrested dreams. Residues of trauma stain the roadside. If curbs could talk, they would speak of bigotry from authorities that have raged our communities, where stopping us disproportionately is routine, and rare is our experience of officers who are exemplary. And some follow supremacist theories and believe inflammatory media stories. Contrived headlines that tell you and I that knife crime is a black on black theme. But if it's more likely to commit atrocities against those stood next to me, that means crime is less about pigmentation and more about proximity. I wonder if for them, our end just justifies their means. The numbers don't add up on their imbalanced sheet of systemic inequities. Living in the bondage of misconceptions, narrow minds lacking in agility, continuing in their quest to profile me.
There's a massive breakdown in terms of cultural understanding, but also in terms of cultural equity. And when you're basically racially profiling people, that's based on your worldview, and that comes down to a lack of education, but also ignorance. So for me now, it's about really educating these officers, revamping their training, but also getting the public to hold the police to account, which they haven't. You know, we've had nearly 2,000 custody deaths since 1990, only one conviction. And that's not justice. So they're supposed to uphold the law and uphold justice, and they're not doing that, even when they're carrying out stop and searches. So this is why the community now has to hold them to account. And this is why I'm really pushing with these training programs with the police.
Do your job, innit? Do you get what I'm trying to say? Like, use our police, you get me? You've got all these tools at your disposal, investigate and do stuff. You shouldn't be pulling over people for no reason and talking about you just want to check this and you just want to check that. Because if that is your attitude, how are you going to go? You got to do it across the board. You know what I'm trying to say? Like, so you got to have the same energy for white people that you have for people of colour. You know what I'm trying to say? Like, because if you're just doing it to black people all the time, then there's a blatant bias and prejudice there. You know what I'm trying to say? And then you're not going to get nothing done. You told them all the time, your hair's stopping me and there's real criminals out there. I'm not doing nothing. I'm just driving. You get what I'm saying? So it's like they take their work home with them too much. Like, this is your job, you're supposed to protect people, do you get what I'm trying to say? But then it's whatever interactions you have on the streets with people, like, you harbour up and some kind of something in you that festers, that you just want to treat everybody the same, do you get what I'm trying to say? Then you want to judge people before you even know what they're doing.
On an institutional level, just stop being racist. On a personal level, i.e. the human being that is fitting the role and has to go to work every day, I understand even if there's a racist culture that they're adhering to, i.e. to help meet quotas or whatever it may be. Like, there's obviously reasons people do things, and sometimes I think we don't question that or scrutinise that enough. But whatever reasons that may be that they over-index in stopping black males, like, as a human, like, that police officer question it internally, innit? If you know there's a certain, I don't know, like, brief issued out on a particular morning when you guys question it, if you know that that's going to highlight young black males in a particular way. Like, tackle it, yeah, tackle the cancer inside out.
Sometimes it's not what they say, it's how they say it. And I think that's I think that's a way of life. I don't know, people that are in relationships with their husbands or wives or whatever, sometimes people get annoyed with how people say things. And it's the same with the police. It's like, It's not how they ask you where you're going or what you're doing or how you got that car. It's the way they say it. So I just think manners doesn't cost anything. And it's a respect thing. If you respect me, I'll respect you.
Done is the days of police officers having hunches and looking at someone saying, "Lord, they look a bit dodgy." So for me, it's profiling itself should be done by really professionals. You know, if you're a forensic psychologist, yeah, you can profile someone and say they've got these narcissistic traits and they sound like they're more prone to commit violence. Cool, you're a scientist, you've studied for that. But giving that to a normal person, we'd all be biased against things that we don't know, things that we're not comfortable with, things that we're not used to. And that's not how policing is supposed to work.
I would say when it comes to like speaking to, you know, people via stop and search, they need to have a bit more respect and manners. They need to understand that their wages are paid by us who pay taxes. But the people that are being stopped as well, I think that they should remember that and have more confidence, but polite confidence when approaching the police or when the police approach them.
Just don't abuse your authority. I feel like a lot of them do. I feel like a lot of them, you know, they act like they're trying to make the community safe, but really and truly in their mind, they're just playing a game of cops and robbers. I feel like they need to, you know, get rid of that mindset and maybe start getting to know people in the community, start with the little kids and that, make them trust you, because no one trusts them right now.
When it's, they've got good cause to stop you, do it. Don't just stop people for no reason, because you're just, it's harassment. You're just making people hate you. Like everyday people going about their lives, you're just making them think, look, like they're just, I'm not doing nothing wrong and I'm just getting stopped. It's gonna put people's backs up.
Man, I just feel like they just see someone dressed like me. When they pull me over, they'll be like, oh, we've seen a lot of people have been pulled over in similar cars like this, so we thought we would pull you over. Why are you painting the brush? You know, do some. They need to do some research as well into the history of why there's a disconnect. And once they start doing that and they show that they want to sort of understand our community, I think that will help still.
Be very mindful, yeah, of previous events and understand why when you approach young black men without plausible reason, if you're gonna approach them, you know, hostile, expect that hostility is gonna come back. So, you know, it's just like anything, you know, the door swings both ways. So for me, it would be police officers specifically, just be a bit more mindful regarding, you know, how you're going about these checks.
Leave us alone. No, I'm joking. Nah, mate, yeah, like just get your facts right and don't just assume, because the assumption is what I think is the problem.
The reality is, yeah, of course there's issues that are happening in, you know, our neighborhoods, yeah? And of course there are people that are carrying out crimes or whatever, right? But the problem is they target a certain ethnic minority most of the times. You know what I mean? It could be black, it could be Asian, usually one of the two. Some would say mainly black, and obviously with the whole George
Floyd
situation, that was, you know, insane. That was just like, you know, watching it live, seeing a man die with the guy's knee on his neck.
Yeah.
I think that just had a global effect on, you know, the world, because, you know, although we have seen certain situations where black men have died at the hands of the police, I think that one just struck a chord. Like, that was insane, you know? The guy's neck is, you know, the guy's knee is on his neck and people are there and he's still got his neck, you know? So, yeah, you know, it's just one of those things that it goes on everywhere. It goes on, it's a global problem. In the UK, I think the best thing that police can do in some ways is try and bridge that gap between working with, I don't know.
Communities?
Yeah, working with communities, working with community workers, youth workers, you know, staying in touch with the people that are actually on the ground working with the youth. Because I think a lot of the times it's the wrong judgment and then it's the wrong act. You know, that's you know, and then by that time it's gone to that to that last resort. So that's what I would say. If police can somehow build a relationship with those people on the ground that know the youth, work with the youth on a daily basis, then that might, you know, prevent these situations like George Floyd, like many of our problems that or situations that have happened in the UK.
The good thing with the cameras these days, right, is that criminals show their truths better than their oaths. Not another routine check. We didn't take this route to be checked. It sounds like you routinely check. Black youths in hoodies and crest. What do you mean routine check? But we didn't take this route to be checked. It feels like you routinely check. Black youths in hoodies and crest.
Your hands dip inside our black Stan Smiths. Search whips for packs and sticks. I wonder why a black man's pissed or some gang shit. You routinely check what us man do on a routine. Wanna know what, where, when and who's been. And 9 times out of 10 it gets peak. Bun feds, bun Jakes, bun Obo. Couple with the fingers up to the constable. I tell him 2-9, said he ain't got time, and his cuffs on my wrist feel uncomfortable. BLM, BLM, don't piss me off, you see me on ends. We told you before on our debut, so don't chat to man like we've been friends.
Not another routine check, we didn't take this route to be checked. It sounds like you routinely check, black youths in hoodies and crest. What do you mean routine check? But we didn't take this route to be checked. It feels like you routinely check, black youths in hoodies and crest. Look, it's the feds, I'm running from them. They want me in pen, put us in cuffs, knee on my neck. R.I.P. George, tell me who's next. I wanna know when will it stop. They just keep pulling up on the block. Tell me take off my shoes and my socks. Tell them, tell them I'm black and a boss. I'm legit, I don't wanna be stopped. I don't want you to put me in cuffs. Catching cases, I pray that I bust. Anytime I see feds, I dust. Yes, yes, I know my rights. I know I'ma be out by tonight. CPS ain't got nothing on me. Free the brothers, I'm back in the streets. Not another routine check. We didn't take this route to be checked. It sounds like you routinely check, black youths in hoodies and crest. What do you mean routine check? But we didn't take this route to be checked. It feels like you routinely check, black youths in hoodies and crest. Lord forgive me if I black out. This means more than a hashtag's worth. Tuesday definitely was paramount, but there's nothing worse than a black hearse. So it's juju all in you racist cops. That's for getting on my damn nerves. See, we've had enough of tasers and glocks, and these on next, they don't damn work. Just because I got a black whip with a black queen, she's got a black purse. She wants to spend on a black ink, she got a black heart, we know my damn worth. It's BLM, BLM, till I cough up BLM. I told you before on my debut, so who you talking to? Like we're all friends. Not another routine check, we didn't take this route to be checked. It sounds like you routinely check, black youths in hoodies and crest. What do you mean routine check? But we didn't take this route to be checked. It feels like you routinely check, black youths in hoodies and crest.